Chanting is for you to come back and be to be here, not to be anywhere else. Om. Om Shri Mahaganapataye Namaha. Om Yaschandasam Rishabho Vishwarupaha Chandobhyo Dhyamruta At Sambhabhuva Samindro Medhaya Asprunotu Amrutasya Devadharano Bhuyasam Shariram Me Vicharshanam Jihva Me Madhumattama Karna Abhyam Bhuri Vishravam Brahmana Kosho Srimedhaya Pihitaha Shrutam Me Gopaya Om Shanti 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 Om Medha Devi Joshamana Agat Vishwachi Bhadra Sumanasya Mana Twaya Jushta Nodamana Duruktaan Brihadvadema Vidathe Suvira Twaya Jushta Rishirbhavati Devetvaya Brahma Gata Shri Rutatvaya Twaya Jushtas Chitram Vindate Vasusano Jushasva Dravinona Medhe Medhamma Indro Dadato Medhan Devi Saraswati Medham Me Ashvina Ubhava Dattam Pushkarasraja Apsarasu chaya medha gandharveshu chayan manaha Ivi medha saraswati sama medha surabhir jushatam Ama medha surabhir vishwarupa hiranyavarna jagati jagamya Urjaswati payasa pinvamana sama medha supratika jushantam Mai medham mai prajam mai agniste jodadatu Mai medham mai prajam mai indra indriyan dadatu Mai medham mai prajam mai suryo brajo dadatu Om Shanti 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 Om Hari Om Tat Sat Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om Om Sada Shiva Samarambham Vyasa Shankara Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Shruti Smriti Purananam Alayam Karunalayam Namami Bhagavat Pada Shankaram Loka Shankaram Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashyakritau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Om Hari Om Tat Sat Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om Om Sahana Vavato Sahana Bhunakto Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Mavidvishavahai Om Shanti 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 Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om We we have completed the Moola Patanam of Ishavasya Upanishad. We have completed the study of the text Ishavasya Upanishad. We have not entered into the commentary of Adishankara Bhagavatpada. And as part of the teaching, I just thought today we will start the commentary part, and before entering into the actual original commentary in Sanskritam, I just thought let me give you in English itself the content of the introductory commentary on Ishavasya Upanishad. The introductory commentary in Sanskritam is called Avatarika Bhashyam. Because if I simply say Avatarika Bhashyam, you won't get frightened, nothing. Introductory commentary. See, when Shankara Bhagavatpadaha intended to write commentary on this particular Upanishad, he had to first of all establish that this Ishavasyam is an Upanishad belonging to or associated with Jnana Kanda portion of the Veda. Why? Because there are people who take this Upanishadic mantras, the mantras obtaining in this, contained in this Upanishad, they take them to be the mantras to be used in the Karma Kanda portion. They associate this with Karma Kanda. So they say this Upanishad mantra, the mantras of this Ishavasya Upanishad are to be used during the performance of rituals. This Upanishad has to be taken to be something associated with, connected to Karma Kanda portion. That is how they see it. For Shankara Bhagavatpada's effort is to establish, first of all, this Upanishad does not belong to Karma Kanda portion. This is an Upanishad, you know, belonging to the Jnana Kanda portion. Only then he can start writing the commentary on this. So he starts Etesham Mantranam Karmasu Aviniyogaha. Aviniyogaha means non-usage of these mantras in the performance of rituals. He starts like that. We call it a statement of pratijna. These mantras are not meant for using in the performance of rituals. Why? He has to establish why these mantras have nothing to do with the Karma Kanda. These mantras are associated with the Jnana Kanda only, he has to say. And for which the first reason he gives is Shruti Pramanam Nasti. Shruti Pramanam means the support to state, to prove that these mantras are used during the performance of rituals. These mantras are used in performance of rituals, or these mantras are associated, connected to the Karma Kanda portion, to state, to prove that there must be some authentic statement from the Veda. Nowhere in Shruti, nowhere in the Veda, it is stated that these mantras of Ishavasyam or to be used in or meant for using in Karmakanda portion. There's no statement. Suppose if there was a statement anywhere in Karmakanda, if it was said, these mantras have to be used, you know, during the performance of rituals. If it was mentioned anywhere, then it is possible for us to say that these mantras are actually associated with Karmakanda. There's no Shruti statement. Therefore, there is no Shruti statement. Okay, this is the first reason he says. Called Shruti Pramanam is not there. Then second point, he goes to second point. What a second point is called, there is no Linga Pramanam. Linga Pramanam is what? Clue. You know, for there is no clue, there is no way, there is nothing to establish, to prove, there is no clue, not even a clue, that to understand that these mantras are associated with the karma. Clue means what? Suppose the karta, the jiva means the individual nature is discussed in this Upanishad. You all know the mantras. The jivatma swarupam is discussed. So the jivatma swarupam discussed in this Upanishad negates the doership. Negates the doership. So these mantras reveal very clearly the nature of the jiva being not up, being opposed to karma. What is the nature of the jiva discussed here, revealed in these mantras? We have a beautiful words. No, pariyagat, shuddham, apapavidham, asnaviram. All those words, I'm going to teach, anyway, see that mantra again. So the seventh mantra, remember, revealing the nature of the Atma. Definitely that mantra reveals the, until the third to the, you can say fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, those mantras reveal the nature of the Atma. There, the doership on the part of the Atma is negated. Which means the nature of the Atma is opposed to the performance of ritual. Performance of any performance, any doing, karma, opposed to karma. Which means the jiva discussed in the Ishavasya Upanishad is a non-doer, not the doer. Suppose if the Ishavasya Upanishad, the jiva discussed in the Ishavasya Upanishad is presented as the doer, then you can say this is associated with karma. But the jiva discussed in this Upanishad is not the doer, but the non-doer. It's clear. Therefore, that is also clue. What is very clear? Because this Upanishad mantras discuss the jiva to be the non-doer, they do not present the jiva as the doer. Therefore, the jiva is not associated with the doership, karma. Therefore, this Upanishad doesn't belong to Karmakandaha. So, karmanga bhuta jiva pratipadanam nasti. Karma anga bhuta jiva pratipadanam nasti. What does mean the jiva presented here, revealed here, is not the one associated with karma as the doer. But the jiva discussed here is the non-doer. Is it clear? It's called Linga Pramanam. point, you got second point. Now the third one we go. Ishal Shankara presents beautifully like this. I removed all Sanskritam and I'm putting it in a like a simple thing. I put say it in everything in English simply for you. Then what's the third aspect, if you see? This Jivatma discussed in this Upanishad, or you can say the Atma. Jiva is Atma. Jiva is another than Atma, the Self. Therefore, Atma is not associated with the karma as the karma phalam. Jiva is not associated with karma as karma, as the fruit of an action also. Karma palatvena api na sambandha asti. What does it mean? Atma is not something which is to be attained as a result of an action. Atma is not the product of an action, a result of an action. Is it clear? To understand that, what he is, Atma is not the karma phalam. Atma is not something to be attained as a result of an action. Therefore, Atma has nothing to do with the action. Therefore, the Atma discussed here being something which is not associated with the karma phalam also. This Upanishad, these mantras form the Upanishad belonging to Jnana Kanda, not the Karma Kanda. To say how Atma is not the result of an action, Atma cannot be attained as a result of an action, he here discusses the four types of fruits of actions. So, Chaturvidha Karma Palani. Whatever fruit of action, whatever action one performs, whatever ritual one performs, whatever meditation one practices, as a result of three types of karma, isn't it? Physical activity or mental activity or oral activity, three types of actions, isn't it? And here again, any karma you perform, whether it's a nityam karma, as is a compulsory duty, naimittikam karma, or you know, or nishiddha, whatever karma you do, whatever karma you, any action you perform, anything you do, that must produce a phalam, result. And those results of any action, no, can be categorized, no, under four groups. Into four, they can be divided. What are they, you say? See, any karma phalam is said to be utpadyam. Karma phalam utpadyam. Utpadyam means producible. Anything which can be produced is called producible, is utpadyam. Like all our agricultural products. You work hard, then you produce, new result is produced. So, utpadyam. And also we can say, suppose you perform, there are rituals like putra kameshti yajnaha. Suppose a person performs, the deserving person, who's young, energetic, still who needs Bhagavan's grace to have a child, and who performs the ritual also, and then he gets a child, means what? That is a utpadyam, isn't it? Which means not directly, somehow that result is there. So utpadyam means what? That which can be produced, that which can be newly produced. Even best example is agricultural products. Then, next type of karma phalam is what? Vikaryam. Vikaryam means any fruit of action is subject to modification. subject to change. No fruit of action will remain forever without undergoing any change. Vikaryam. The nature of the fruits of actions are beautifully analyzed and presented. Utpadyam, now Vikaryam. The third type of fruit of action, Aapyam. Aapyam means attainable, reachable. As a result of an action, something can be attained, something can be reached. By running from here, you can reach another place. By doing something, what you have not attained before, you can attain. Isn't it? Suppose you were not rich before, now you can attain riches. You were far away and you have reached this place. This is as a result of an action, a result can be attained. So attainable is called aapyam. Aapyam phalam, vikaryam phalam, utpadyam phalam. Now fourth type of fruit also is there. Fourth type of phalam. Samskaryam. Samskaryam means refinable, purifiable. It's called samskaryam. I want to, these are all, it's all actually in, if you take these nouns here used as nouns, actually you can, they're all potential passive participles are used here as noun, the form of noun, adjectives here for the fruits of actions. Utpadyam palam, vikaryam palam, producible fruit, modifiable fruit, reachable, attainable fruit, then refinable, purifiable fruit, samskaryam. Got this now? In, we have the nouns, utpattihi, production, vikritihi, modification, aptihi, attainment, samskritihi, refinement. I'm telling you the noun forms of the same thing. So these are, any fruit you attain, you can bring under these four categories. So Atma, is Atma utpadyaha? Is Atma producible? No. Atma is not utpadyaha. Why? Because, why it is not producible? Nityatvat. Atma, you can learn Sanskritam like this. Atma na utpadyaha nityatvat. Due to the nature of being eternal, Atma is not producible, therefore Atma is not the product of karma. Atma cannot be the fruit of an action. The next, is Atma vikaryaha? Is Atma subject to change? No, Atma avikaryaha. Atma is not subject to any modification, non-modifiable, isn't it? Mm-hmm. What is the reason we have to say? Because ashariratvat, avikaryatvat, Atma na vikaryaha. Atma is of the nature of formlessness. Why? Because Atma is bodiless, isn't it? No shariram for Atma. Atma is free from physical body, subtle body, isn't it? And also causal body also. Atma being free from the three types of bodies, or you can say five layers of personality, Atma is free from, Atma is of the nature of formlessness, isn't it? Therefore, Atma is not subject to any change, subject to change. There avikaryatvat, asharirutvat, आत्मा न विकार्यः, आत्मा इज नॉट सब्जेक्ट टू चेंज. Therefore, what is Atma is not the fruit of an action. Okay, second option. Now third. Apyaha. So Atma, Apyam is the fruit of an action. Atma is not Apyaha, Anapyaha. Atma is not attainable or reachable. Why? Sarvagatatvat. Due to the all pervasiveness, you have to say that you have to learn this, okay? Hetvarte Panchami. What is the cause for stating? Isn't why do you say Atma had attainable? Due to its all pervasiveness. Sarvagatatvat. Atma is of the nature of all pervasiveness. Therefore, Atma is not reachable or attainable. And the next one. Atma is not refinable, purifiable. Isn't it? Atma asamskaryaha. Why? Shuddhatvat. Shuddhat due to its purity. Already pure need not be purified. Cannot be purified. You are non-refinable, non-purifiable shuddhatvat. Therefore, what? Atma is not samskaryaha. Here, the samskaryaha is what? I can say the noun forms again, utpattihi, vikritihi, then aptihi, samskritihi. We can also say samskaraha also we can say. Samskaraha, masculine noun, samskritihi, feminine noun. So what, so samskaraha or samskritihi means refinement. Isn't it? Purify. Here, the refinement is always of two types. The two types of purification or refining. One is guna apanayana samskaraha. Dosha apanayana samskaraha. Guna adana samskaraha. Dosha apanayana samskaraha. See, removal of the, you can refine something by doing two things, isn't it? You can convert this, now there's a wall here. You can make this wall, purify this wall, refine this wall. How can you do, what can you do? First you scrub it. Through scrubbing, you're removing the dirt, isn't it? Removal of the dirt through scrubbing is also what? Refinement. Refinement through removal. Isn't it? Through removal. And the refinement through addition also. Then afterwards you paint it. That's called guna adana. Isn't it? Embellishing something is also what? Making it appear better, making it look better, making it shine. That's also what? Refinement. Isn't it? So addition, embellishing it or through addition of something, you look it, make it look better. It's also what now? So refinement. You paint it. That's called guna adana karma. So first, what you do, you scrub all the dirt. That's also what now? This is a refinement only, but through the removal of something, which makes it look ugly, isn't it? So dosha apanayana dvara samskara, isn't it? Apanayana and guna adana. Okay, by lending some beauty, you refine it. By removing the defect, you refine it. We have two types of, isn't it? Refinement. And here, Atma, you need not remove anything from Atma. There's no dirt, there's no impurity, blemish or sin, anything on the part of Atma. Isn't it? Therefore, nothing, dosha apanena samskaraha. The refinement in terms of removal of something undesirable, unwanted, blemish, sin, etc. also is not possible. Isn't it? Therefore, dosha apanena also is not possible. you need not may improve the atma. Therefore, guna adhanam also is not possible. Already it is pure. So we have to say shuddhatvat apapaviddhatvat. Because already atma is unafflicted by any punya papa. It's free from all asangatvat. Free, it is untainted by any punya papa, any results of any sins, etc. Therefore, atma is what? Asamskaryaha. It's clear now? Therefore, if atma is non-refinable, non-reachable, non-attainable, non-modifiable, non-changeable, non-producible, atma cannot be the product of karma, cannot be the result of karma. Atma is not karma phalam. Therefore what? Atma is not the karma phalam. Therefore atma has nothing to do with the karma. Therefore the mantra here revealing the nature of the atma being such, this Upanishad does not belong to karma kandaha. Is it clear? Is what he says. Thereafter, the three aspects are covered now. Now the fourth aspect. The Purupakshi, you know, sees. Instead of seeing these words, because there's a mantra with words implying the nature of the Atma. What is that mantra? Sapariyagat, pariyagat, shuddham, shukram, asnaviram. No, we heard that. Remember, we read that verse. So that mantra reveals the nature of the Atma. He says, why can't we take these words as glorification of the Jiva? Instead of taking the meaning of these words implying the swarupam of the Atma, why can't we take the meaning of these words as glorification of the Atma? Then you can say what? This Upanishad belongs to Karmakanda. If you take it as nature of the Atma, it negates doership, etc., isn't it? Therefore, suppose the Purupakshi asks, what is the answer? See, in the Veda, whenever we come across statements or words of glorifications or some stories, those statements are said to be Arthavada Vakyani. Arthavada Vakyam. I want all of you to know this. Arthavada Vakyam means a statement or a portion consisting of statements revealing or talking about a story, presenting a story, or glorifying something, something associated there in the context. You may come across a lot of glorifications of, you know, some Indra, Varuna, etc., glorifications of devatas, glorification of the results of actions, glorifications of the pleasures enjoyable in Swarga. Like how you come and glorify, fantastic, how it was nice. We went to that temple and we had prasadam there, it was very nice. We always say something. Like that here, the glorification, something to do, no? Whenever you may come across, definitely it is possible for one to come across such statements in the Veda. So it can be in Upanishad or any Karmakanda portion or Jnanakanda portion. If we come across the portion consisting of statements revealing a story or glorifications, etc., then that portion is called Arthavada portion. அர்த்தவாத வாக்கியம், அர்த்தவாத வாக்கியானி, ஸ்டேட்மெண்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் குளோரிஃபிகேஷன்ஸ், ப்ரேஸ் ஆர் நோ கனெக்ட் அசோசியேட்டட் வித் ஸ்டோரிஸ் எக்ஸெட்ரா. ஸோ இஃப் தோஸ் ஸ்டோரிஸ் ஆர் தேர், தென் இம்மீடியட்லி வாட் நோ இட் மஸ்ட் பி கனெக்டட் டு அ விதி. விதி மீ தேர் மஸ்ட் பி சம் ஸ்டேட்மெண்ட் ஆஃப் நோ விதி ஆல்சோ மஸ்ட் பி தேர். The statement of wherever Arthavada Vakyam is, or wherever Arthavada Vakyani are there, wherever the statements of glorification or story, the portions of stories come, there, that in that portion, there must be somewhere the Vidhi Vakyani also, or Vidhi Vakyam must be there. A Vidhi Vakyam means what? A statement of order must be there. Is it clear? If there is no Vidhi Vakyam, then that portion, you can't take it as Arthavada portion. So here, because this Purapakshi asks, why should we not take these words, in the Ishavasya Upanishad, which words? The words revealing the Swarupa of the Atma. These words revealing the Swarupa of the Atma, why can't they be taken as Stuti? Now, Stuti means glorification of the Atma. If you take it as a glorification of the Atma, then he can say what? It belongs to Karmakanda. So, Shankar Bhagavatpada says, there are only 18 mantras. Where do you find Vidhi Vakyam? There is no statement of Vidhi at all. There is no statement of order. It cannot be connected to any Karmakanda portion. Therefore, there is no Vidhi Vakyam. Therefore, there is no Arthavada Vakyam also. Arthavada portion also is not there. These words are not glorifications, do not reveal the glorification of the Atma. They really reveal the Swarupam of the Atma being non-doer, non-enjoyer. Okay, these words reveal what? These words reveal only Swarupam of the Jivatma. Swarupam of the Jiva. What is Swarupam of the Jiva? Atma. What is the nature of the Atma? Saparyagat, all pervasiveness is the nature of the Atma. Shukram. Purity is the nature of the Atma. Free from ignorance, that is revealed, that is the nature of the Atma. Then apapaviddhatvam. Apapaviddha means what? Atma is unafflictedness of unafflictedness, untaintedness being the nature of the Atma is revealed here. Then oneness of the Atma is discussed here. Therefore, this is the nature of, this is the Atma Swarup alone is discussed here. But to perform karma, there must be what? There must be kartrutvam, there must be doership, then there must be enjoyership, there must be, associated with the karma, phalam. There is bahuttam also. In karma means there must be plurality also, not oneness. But these mantras reveal the nature of the Atma. But what we need for karma is diagonally opposite of what is being said here. Therefore, this portion, this Upanishad mantra doesn't belong to the Karmakanda portion, it belongs only to the Jnanakanda portion. Okay, he says, here are the four aspects. Now, after this, interesting thing comes. Shankara Bhagavatpada continues his commentary, and which is an answer. There is no objection. Okay? Therefore, we have to means what? Here, actually Swamiji helps us to understand the possible objection one can raise in this context. What is that possible objection one can raise here, for which the answer is already there? But objection is not in the commentary Bhashyam. What is that objection? The question comes. See, karma kandaha of the Veda. See, karma kandaha, jnana kandaha, both two kandas. In karma kanda itself, okay, include upasana kanda. Okay? Karma kandaha, jnana kandaha, pravritti margaha, nivritti margaha. Two portion, two kandas together, isn't it? Two pravrit margas together constitute the entire Veda Shastra. Entire Veda. Here in the karma kanda, jiva is accepted, assumed as karta. In jnana kanda, jiva is presented as akarta, non-doer. In karma kanda, jiva is accepted as karta. In jnana kanda, jiva is accepted as, revealed as the non-doer. Got it? Therefore, can these two both be the facts? Can there be two facts? Jiva is karta, is it a fact? Jiva is akarta, which is it a fact? Edu unmai. What is a fact here? Because both are revealed by what? Veda. How can there be two facts? If jiva is a karta, jiva cannot be akarta. If jiva is akarta, then jiva cannot be akarta. Jiva can be both karta and akarta. Why? Why should we not accept it both? Like, you know, Swamiji says, like, for everything you can tell, like Tanjavur Bommai, you know. Puja Swamiji, when he does it very beautiful, it looks, for everything. Sometimes now people want to be very, it's called diplomacy. You can't understand whether people, do you accept it, you don't accept it. You have to see Tanjur Bommai, okay, the dolls. I wish I had one to show. Yeah, because you can't make a voice, you say yes or no. Both are okay. Is jiva karta? Jiva akarta? Means what? It's not possible for, but they can't be both, you know. One must be the fact. One must be a non-fact, isn't it? One must be absolutely right, one must be relatively right. They both cannot be absolutely right facts, isn't it? No. It's impossible to compromise in jnanam, in the field of knowledge. You cannot compromise. You cannot say yes, it's not to please. You are like Narmada so much. How can I say no to her? No, whatever you say is correct. I like you very much. With due respect, my love for you is different, but I have to disagree with you. What to say is not correct. Because that's not, isn't it? In knowledge, no compromise. Therefore, isn't it? Fact. What is a fact? Jiva is akarta is a fact. Okay. Jiva is akarta is a fact. Why? Because he has to say further. Paraspara viruddha dharmau ekasmin dharmini na syatam. In one locus, the contradictory attributes, dharmas, opposed to each other, cannot coexist in one locus. Doership and non-doership are opposed to each other, isn't it? You can say tall person, but very thin he is. A tall person, but he is very thin. It is the right expression. He is very short and he is very fat. Or he is very thin, you can say that. A tall and a fat, you can say. Isn't it? Because they are not opposed to each other. You can't say tall, short, he's very tall, the tall person, but he's very short. It's not possible because their tallness and shortness are opposed to each other. Paraspara viruddha dharmo. Fat and thin cannot be in the same locus. One person cannot be fat and thin simultaneously. He used to be very fat. And he lost a lot of weight. I wish you can say next time and see me. You know what I'm saying? Which means, so paraspara viruddha dharmo ekasmin dharmini nasyatam means what? They cannot, you know, the contradictory opposite attributes cannot coexist in one locus. But Vedas, Karmakanda states that Karmakanda states, what does Karmakanda state? Karmakanda assumes the jiva to be the doer. But Jnanakanda negates the jiva's doership. Jnanakanda presents jiva as a non-doer, akarta. And we cannot say, What cannot be said? We can't say, okay, let us take only Karmakanda as a pramanam. We cannot say that. Or let us take only Jnanakanda as the pramanam, as an authentic, valid means of knowledge. So we can take only one as the fact, isn't it? Can we take only one? That's also not possible. No way. The entire Veda, Karmakanda and Jnanakanda together as an entire Veda serves as a means of knowledge, pramanam. Both together serve as a pramanam, a means, valid means of knowledge. If we take only one portion, it is not possible for you to take any one portion as a means of knowledge. It's called Ardha Jaratiya Nyayaha. Ardha Jaratiya Nyayaha means what? No, you cannot say, yeah, one portion of my body alone has become what? From here to one portion, one side, my body has become very, very old. The one side of the body remains very young. This side of the body has what? 20-year-old look. This side of the body looks 70-year-old look. Half body has become old, half body is still young. Whole body has to become old. Our whole body should be young, isn't it? Ardha Jaratiyam. Half becoming old, half remaining young is not possible. Isn't it? Suppose we go to the doctor and tell the doctor, you know, my right hand is, doctor, always very painful. It's very painful. I'm going through suffering a lot of pain on my right hand. Suppose, you know, not in the left hand. Okay. Because only one hand, if we go to the doctor for only one hand's pain, okay? Because before it comes second hand, you go to the doctor. The doctor will ask you, how old are you? You know, I'm not at 80. I'm going to be 80 soon. oh, you're 80 year old, that is why you have this problem. No, no, this hand also is 80 years old. This, like this hand, isn't it? What does it mean? See, it is not ardha jaratiya nyayaha. Is it like just only one portion of the body cannot become old, one portion of the body cannot become remain young, the entire body has to become old or it must be young. Similarly, entire Veda has to be taken as a pramanam. You can't take only one part of the Veda as a pramanam, as a means of knowledge. Isn't it? Therefore, the question comes, how is that Veda Karma Kanda presents Jiva as a Karta, Jnana Kanda presents Jiva as Akarta non-doer? So what is the fact? Which should be taken? What is the ultimate aim of the, what is revealed by the pramanam? What is the ultimate fact revealed by the pramanam? Meda. Is doership or non-doership? Got it? So here comes, the answer comes like this. Because the Purupakshi, it is possible for him to ask, in the Veda it is said, Swarga Kamaha Jyotishtomena Yajeta. The one who wants to attain Swarga, may he perform the Jyotishta Homa. One who wants progeny, may he perform Putra Kameshti Yaga. Like this we have lots of, so which means the very Karmakanda prescribes rituals, isn't it? And expects the Karmakandi to perform the rituals and enjoy the fruits also. Very clear. Therefore he says, Veda itself, if you take the entire Veda as a pramanam, Veda itself says, may one perform this ritual for this end. May one perform this particular ritual for this end. May one practice this meditation and along with this ritual for accomplishing this end. Samuchyana we saw even, isn't it? Like Veda itself prescribes in the Karmakanda. Then is it not pramanam? Therefore here, Shankar was first he makes it very clear one thing. You've already heard about one vakyam called Arthavada Vakyam. Now you know, in Veda, the Arthavada Vakyam means what? You know that. Arthavada Vakyam, which comes along with the Vidhi Vakyam, is not to be taken as Pramana Vakyam. Understand? That is for a given purpose. That is used on the Karmakanda. And second thing, he first of all explains what a pramanam is. Please understand this. What is a pramanam? The ultimate aim of the entire Veda is to help you discover the real nature of the Atma, thereby to discover the freedom which is already there. This is the ultimate aim. But still, in the very Karma Kanda, Veda prescribes the karmas. And what? So here, Veda accepts the Kartrutva. No doubt, Veda accepts. In the Karma Kanda, the Jiva is accepted to be the doer, accepted as the doer. But first of all, you should understand what is a pramanam. See, anadhigata अर्थबोधकम प्रमाणम इज अ डेफिनेशन ब्रीफ डेफिनेशन इट्स अ लॉन्ग सेंटेंस इज देयर आई वांट टू अंडरस्टैंड वन थिंग एंड यू हैव टू रियली लर्न दिस वाट इज अ प्रमाणम अनधिगत अर्थबोधकम प्रमाणम adhigata means something already understood anadhigata means what has not been understood already which means unknown adhigata means known anadhigata means unknown anadhigata arthabodhakam means bodhakam means that which brings to light that which reveals so pramanam is that which reveals something which is already unknown here veda is looked upon as a pramanam because it reveals is supposed to it does reveal something which is already unknown to you is it clear it cannot reveal something which is already known to you already known to you need not be revealed if it reveals already something known to you why should you waste your time and break your head to study the vedanta isn't it so the very definition of pramanam is what that which reveals what is already unknown to you anadhigata arthabodhakam natu adhigata arthabodhakam got it therefore Veda is meant for revealing something which is already unknown. It does reveal what is already unknown to us. What is not already unknown to us? Akartrutvam. How the Atma is of the nature of actionlessness, which is not known to us, isn't it? Atma being the non-doer is unknown to us. Okay. And then one need not study the karma kanda to know that one is a doer. Got it? So Veda does not reveal the jiva being the doer. Karmakanda of the Veda does not reveal the jiva being the doer. Karmakanda of the Veda only takes jiva as the doer, which is already known to the jiva, known to everyone. Being born a human being, every one of us already assume about ourselves. Isn't all of us we have the misconception we do not think it is a misconception we think already we know we are the doers I am the doer I am the enjoyer I am the achiever I am going to achieve this all these things we have already isn't it you need not study karmakanda of the veda to know you are the doer you already know you are the doer This is the knowledge you have about yourself already. What is already known to you, I am the doer, I am the enjoyer, I am the sufferer. All these notions you have about yourself are already you have. Do you need to study karmakanda to know you are the doer? No. Therefore, when karmakanda presents the karmas, no, and assuming the jiva as the doer, which is already known to you so whenever then that portion those statements are called anuvada vakyani now we are learning a new sentence isn't it anuvada vakyam means anuvadaha means restatement the restatement means what if veda restates what is already known to you That statement is not a statement of means of knowledge. That is not a pramana vakyam, but anuvada vakyam. Is it clear? So Karmakanda portion, in Karmakanda, when Veda talks about Jiva as the doer, accepts Jiva as the doer, so those statements of acceptance of Jiva as the doer are Anuvada Vakyani, not Pramana Vakyani. They do not, which means what? Anuvada Vakyani restate what you already think about yourself. They do not reveal the nature of yourself. They do not reveal the nature of the Atma. Is it clear now? Therefore, they are not the Pramanam. Pramana Vakyani. Then the question comes, then why does Veda prescribe all this? Because suppose Veda, when he starts, always Veda Mata, Shruti Mata, as a mother, he does not find fault with you. You are wrong. You know, whatever you think about yourself is very wrong. If somebody says no, like box means, what will you do? You already are helpless, not knowing what to do. You already are guilty. So already guilty person, already suffering person, needs only love, warmth and care. So Veda accepts you totally as you are. That is why mother, okay? And also Pat, you are 100% right. You are the doer. You are the sufferer. You are a mumukshu. Yes, you are a seeker of moksha. You are bound. Yes, you are a samsari. Veda accepts. Whatever notions you have, Veda accepts. When Veda accepts you, very good. Then you feel up. Somebody who understands me, who accepts me, then you love Veda. Then make you sit on the lap and mother back in your stroke, you are wrong, my child. You are wrong. You can't, no? That is what the Veda does. Understand? So accepts you as you are. With all your wrong misconceptions and notions you have to accept. Veda has to win your heart first. The very beginning itself, you are wrong. You are not the doer. You are not the enjoyer. You are free from all these things. Where is bondage for you? Why do you need to have mukshittam at all? You are already free. You are not bound. There is no need for you to seek moksha at all. If Veda says, we will run away from Veda. You don't know how much I'm suffering. You know, this is not the way. When somebody comes to you suffering, isn't it? So all you have to, you have to learn Vedic psychology, okay? You don't need to be diplomatic. It's not diplomacy. It's a genuine care. So diplomacy means cheating also is involved, okay? Because I had to get my thing done, so I had to be, let me not look into, overlook. Let me overlook other person's thing. That's not the way. Genuine care. Diplomacy in business is okay, but not in Shastra, isn't it? And there's no, it's a genuine care. When the child does something, no, if you say, that is why whenever, when you want to point out somebody's mistakes, first stroke, your right's okay, not wrong. Put the hand on your shoulder, bring closely, then slowly say, no. No, give him one something to eat and drink. First, fill his stomach, see that he's okay, not hungry anymore. Then slowly, make him sit in a cool, nice place, not in the hot weather, okay? Then say something nicely, and then that person, yeah. Then he'll understand. That's a nice way of doing things, isn't it? Amazing. That's why Veda, why we call Veda mother? Shruti Mata, that's the reason. So the whole Karmakanda accepts you as you are, presents the karma. So don't take the restatement of what your misconceptions. You already know about yourself, what you already thinking of yourself. That is only Anuvada Vakyam, not Pramana Vakyam. What is Pramana Vakyam? If na anadhigata bodhakam, artha bodhakam. What is unknown to you, if it is, is brought to light mean? That is pramanam. Only then pramana vakyam. Paryagat asnaviram avranam asnaviram akayam shuddham apapavidham. All these terms, they reveal something what is unknown to you. So what does this word paryagat? Paryagat, paryagat negates spatial limitation. By revealing your nature, so Atma Swarupam being all pervasiveness. Shukram negates the dirt, impurity in the form of ignorance, avidya. Not that, it negates the Atma being free from causal body. Asnaviram negates, asnaviram avranam, two words negate Atma being free from gross body. Akayam negates Atma being free from subtle body. So these three words, by negating the three bodies on the part of the Atma, they reveal the formlessness of, and also formlessness and indestructibility of the Atma. Apapa Vidham negates afflictedness on the part of the Atma. So unafflictedness, untaintedness, being the nature of the Atma is revealed by that word. So all these words negate all the wrong notions. Not now, only they reveal the Swarupa of the Atma, what is not known to you. So only that is Pramana Vakyam. So that mantra is what? Mantra consists of a sentence, statement of pramanam, pramana vakyam. So what is a pramana vakyam? In jnana kanda you have pramana vakyam. In karma kanda you have anuvada vakyani. Is it clear? Even the whole Veda is taken to be the pramanam. Because one is for preparation, other one is for knowledge. Put it off, talk to her afterwards. And he says, not only Veda accepts your misconceptions, it adds some more misconceptions to you also. For one to be able to perform the karma, you must have what? You must have certain qualifications. Veda presents that. What are the qualifications you should have to be the performer of the karma, to enjoy the benefits of, the fruits of the rituals or karma prescribed in the karma kanda? You must have certain qualifications. What are they? Veda adds, already you have your own qualifications, misconceptions about the self. Veda also adds to them. Karmakanda presents some more, which are negated later on in the Jnana Kanda. What are they? First thing, Arthitvam. Arthitvam means what? Being an Arthi. Arthi means the seeker, the desirer, one who is desirous of ends. she says, if you are not desirous of accomplishing ends, then you are not qualified for doing any karma. Well, be desirous, first of all, isn't it? Arthitva means what? Enjoying the status of being the desirer, one who is full of desires, one who is was lots of desires. That is the qualification. Okay, you want lots of money, then dhanarthi may one perform vayavya yaga. Putrarthi, no, really, suppose he perform putra kamesh yagaha. Means who is the one who should have this desire? Only agrihastaha. Desire for child, who can have? Not a brahmachari, not eligible, not qualified, not a vanaprasthi, not a sannyasi, not at all a sannyasi. Isn't it? Desire for putra is not inappropriate, but who should have, who is adhikari, who is eligible to have the desire? Not any of the ashramites, only a householder. Even that household also, however, I'm still not a sannyasi, I'm still a householder, but no, I'm only 70. No. Or even if you're a householder 25, living on government benefits, kuchelaha. No. You should have, you must be a man, isn't it? No. Therefore, there is adhikaritvam is there. Who should be? Arthitvam is very important, isn't it? One, you must be desirous. Being desirous is the qualification. So you must be an arthi. You must be a desirer. You must be the one who has lots of desires to perform the rituals. And must be eligible also, qualified, to have the proper desires. And I want to have children, but I want government to pay for all my children. Maha Adharma, isn't it? Anyway, I don't want to get into that. Then also we have next qualification. Dvijatvam. Dvijatvam means one must have the status of being the dvijaha. One must think, I'm an arthi, I have lots of desires and I'm eligible to do that. You know? Then dvijatva means what? Dvijaha means the one who is twice born. Who is a twice born? Twice born here means the one who has gone through, don't think of something big, okay? The one who has gone through the ritual of upanayanam, yajna upavita karma. So in Vedic culture, there's a particular ritual called upanayanam. Having got it done, the child would have got the sacred thread, upavitam, which means such a person is qualified, eligible for performing, for first of all studying Veda, then performing rituals. That is why don't worry about yajna upavita karma, all of you, okay? Jnanam doesn't require all those things. Only for karma you need all that. This is the answer, the latest answer, I think even Peter gave to somebody. Last answer he gave, somebody asked, oh, I haven't gone through upanayana karma, I have not got my yajna upavitam thread, sacred thread, so I'm not eligible for studying Veda adhyayanam, then I cannot study Veda, then I cannot attain jnanam, then how am I, you know, which means I'm a deprived of the attainment of knowledge. No. Only for Veda adhyayanam, only for performance of rituals prescribed in the karma kanda, isn't it? One must have gone through the upanayanam karma, one must have got this yajna upavitam thread. So don't worry, people who are inspiring for jnanam, you don't need to worry about what has not happened. Understand? And therefore, there is a good blessing. So here, for he Shankara says in commentary, dvijatvam. So which means to be eligible for performing rituals, no, one must have also done some Veda Dhyanam, for which one must have gone, has the sacred thread, and for which one must have gone through the ritual of Upanayanam. The one who has gone through Upanayanam alone is called what? Dvijaha. Is it clear? Therefore, and for to go through that ritual also, to have the thread also, one must be a Brahmanaha, Kshatriyaha, Vaishyaha. So he must have Abhimana, he must have all these notions. I am a Brahmanaha, I am a Kshatriyaha, I am Vaishyaha. That, you know, first of all, is a Varna identity he must have. You know, and aham dvijaha, I got my thread done, na madhikari, he must have all these all these notions, misconceptions one would have, isn't it? These are all the qualifications who prescribes, karma kanda itself prescribes. Dvijatvam. Then late, one more is there. Dakshatvam. Dakshatvam means capability. One must be capable. Are they enjoying the status of being the capable person? Capability means what? Perform a ritual means one must be a daksha. Daksha means what? First of all, he must be physically hale and healthy, strong person, capable person. Because many times you have to get up and sit and do namaskaram, and understand, it's not that easy, isn't it? You saw the day. How many times you get up and do namaskaram, all those things? First of all, you know, I can't sit, the back is aching, I can't get up many times, means your ritual means you have to sit for hours, isn't it? So not something, dakshatvam. Not only physically being fit, you can't say, you know, I have some, any, you suppose the physically disabled, a lame person is not eligible to do karma. Because how can you do? You need support of other people. How can you do karma? You're not undermined. To do anything, you need your own, first of all, help. How can you perform rituals? Karma. So dakshatvam. Not only that, you must be able to give dakshina also. You must have a lot of money. Now I want to perform rituals, but I go begging every day, means. How can you do that? You must know. And at least you can't even have an account. Next month I'll pay you from my account. Now, yay, again, you can't say, no, dakshina, I'll pay you from next month. Mm-hmm. No, immediately, as soon as the karma is over, you have to pay the give dakshina also. Which means it involves expenditure. So this is called dakshatvam. No, I mean, eligibility, being capable of performing rituals. So, aham dakshaha, I am very capable, I am eligible, I have all the fitness, I have money, and also I'm reduced actually. Lots of things are there, you know, I have a shika, and I have a, you know, lots of things I can say. As to perform a ritual, there's some more lakshanams also are there. How should be the performer, etc. No, I'm not elaborating on those things. Three aspects Shankara mentions here. One, you know, the enjoying the status of being the person of desires and enjoying the status of being the dvijaha, enjoying the status of being the capable, person of capability, is it? All these are all qualifications. Now, Veda Karmakanda itself adds some more qualifications, so that you can have more misconceptions about you. Not only already what you have, all for what? It's called, you know, first of all, accepting you as you are and making you, you know, what suppose like whatever Anuj wants one day, bat means, and then Siddhartha has to go all the way. He won't say no. Go and look for a bat, and even the shop is simply show some shop, isn't it? Take accepting you as you are. It's called with all love and warmth, Upadaya. Veda, what does Veda Mata do? Accepting you from where you are. Wherever you are sitting in the gutter, Veda comes down to the gutter. To why? To bring you out of the gutter. You are sitting in slush, Veda comes down to the slush to bring you, uplift you from there. No, I won't come there. If you say, I won't come, and don't worry, my baby, I'll come there. Comes down, holds your hand, isn't it? Brings you up. That's what Veda does. That's why Karma Kanda, they prescribes all these things. And the acceptance of all the misconceptions, what you hold, what you have already about yourself, adding some more to what you already have, you know, is only restating what you know about yourself. That restatement of all the notions you have about yourself are called Anuvada Vakyani. They are not Pramana Vakyani. Pramana Vakyani means what? Revealing something what you do not know already. Therefore, in the Ishavasya Upanishad mantras, nowhere we have, you know, the verses in the beginning until the 8th mantra, isn't it? What we have, all those verses reveal the Atma Swarupam. Understand? Relatively, Jiva is a doer. Even then, we have to say, even then, the doer is not the Jiva. The doer is Atma, relatively, isn't it? Jiva means what? Jiva is Atma. Relatively doer. Absolutely non-doer. What is a fact? What is relative should be taken as a fact, or what is absolute should be taken as a fact? Which should be taken as a fact? Relative or the absolute? Therefore, Veda actually only reveals the Pramana Vakyams. In this Upanishad, we have only Pramana Vakyani, not Anuvada Vakyani, not Arthavada Vakyani, not Vidhi Vakyani are not there. Arthavada Vakyani are not there. You get what I'm saying? And we have explained to you, isn't it? There are no restatements are not there, which means the only Pramana Vakyani are there. Is it clear? Therefore, what does it do? By revealing the Swarupam of the Atma, it resolves the, through the revelation of the Swarupam, it negates the very, it resolves the ignorance. Okay? Ignorance is resolved, which means through the resolution of ignorance, ignorance caused bondage. Also is what? All the problems, samsara is also resolved. It what? No? It reveals yourself, your real self, the jiva swarupam, being free from shokaha mohaha. How does it reveal the jiva swarupam being free from shoka moha, grief and delusion? A delusion and grief, isn't it? How? By removing the ignorance. In ignorance, you can't help having grief and sorrow. In knowledge, there can't be grief and sorrow. So it relieves you, it helps you discover the self being already free from grief and delusion. Delusion and delusion caused grief, sorrow. For which it resolves, only through the resolution of ignorance, it helps you discover freedom from delusion and sorrow. For resolving the ignorance, it reveals what? Only by revealing the nature, swarupam, being free from ignorance. So, Atma Swarupa Jnana Dwara, ಅಜ್ಞಾನ ನಿವೃತ್ತಿಯ ಸಂಸಾರ ನಿವೃತ್ತಿ. ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಟೇಕನ್ ಕೇರ್ ಆಫ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಉಪನಿಷತ್, ವಿಚ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಆತ್ಮಜ್ಞಾನಂ, ನಾಲೆಡ್ಜ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಆರ್ ಜೀವ ಈಸ್ ಆತ್ಮ. ವಾಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಜೀವ? ಜೀವ ಈಸ್ ಆತ್ಮ. ಜೀವ ಇಸ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಎ ನೇಮ್ ಗಿವನ್ ಟು ಆತ್ಮ obtaining in the body mind sense complex, individual body mind sense complex. The swarup means definitely atma. Atma is, this is the real nature of the atma. Therefore it's only just the ignorance centered on I is resolved. So what is ajnanam? Ajnanam also is anadi, swabhavika ajnanam. The beginningless swabhavikam ajnanam means what? Swabhavika means natural. Natural means what? Uncreated. That's why nobody has created ignorance, isn't it? Atma has not created ignorance. Who has created? Ajnanam is something swabhavikam means natural, uncreated. Understand, uncreated means what? It is resolvable. Swarupa means it is non-resolvable. Swabhavika means resolvable. Understand this difference. So in fact you are not destroying anything here, only resolve the ajnanam, which is the cause of samsara. By knowing the truth of the very ajnanam, you resolve the ignorance by knowing the very truth of the ignorance. There's no such a thing called destruction of anything here or destroying here. No, by knowing the truth of ignorance you are resolving the very ignorance, which is natural, isn't it? It's uncreated. There, by resolving the ignorance, you discover, through the resolution of ignorance, you are helped to discover the self being already free from delusion and grief. One thing has to be very clear. Ignorance and jnana knowledge cannot coexist, we said. Remember, here Upanishad reveals what? Reveals the nature of the Atma. Thereby what jnanam rises in you? Knowledge of the Atma. Upanishad, by negating what Atma is not, it reveals the nature of the Atma. Isn't it? Through the understanding of the nature of the Atma, the knowledge that rises is of the Atma. So knowledge of the Atma is opposed to ignorance of the Atma. Isn't it? Therefore, knowledge of the Atma is opposed to what? Ignorance of the Atma. Knowledge is opposed to ignorance. Why? Knowledge drives away ignorance. Therefore, self-knowledge will remove which ignorance? Only self-ignorance. What I want to say, knowledge of physics is not opposed to chemistry ignorance. Our computer knowledge is not opposed to Sanskrit ignorance. Is it clear? Therefore, it will not remove all the ignorance. Don't have all confusion. Self-knowledge will remove only self-ignorance. That is only ignorance which is the cause of your samsara. Chemistry ignorance is not cause of your samsara. Physics is not the cause of samsara. Your shoka, moha, is it moha, shoka, nivrityartham? What you want is not physics, chemistry, knowledge. Only atma ajnanam only has to be resolved. For which you need only atma jnanam. But does not mean physics, chemistry, knowledge is not undermined here. You need to have physics knowledge, chemistry knowledge, mathematics knowledge, language knowledge, everything to discipline your mind, to prepare your mind, to make your mind sharpened, subtle, to be able to understand, attain the knowledge of the self. That is why apara vidya is for preparation. And only the prepared mind can have para vidya, which is moksha. Is it clear? Finished. We'll see. Maybe when you come for, I may have to say a few more things, but this is the content of the introductory commentary. So now Shankar Bhagavatpada says, therefore, now these mantras of this Upanishad are not meant for using in karmakand, during the performance of rituals. This Upanishad doesn't belong to karmakanda. Karmasu etesha mantranam karmasu aviniyogaha. Okay, therefore, what is the nigamanam means what? Final conclusion. This reveals anadhigatam, what is unknown to you. This reveals only the Atma Swarupam. This reveals the Atma being the non-doer, non-enjoyer. Atma being free from doership, enjoyership, grief and sorrow and ignorance. Therefore, this is what? This is only Pramana Grantaha. Therefore, it belongs to the Jnanakanda portion only. This, which is the final aim. Actually, not only the Upanishads, even texts like Smriti Granthas like Bhagavad Gita, other even Prakrana Granthaha, they also purely deal with knowledge, not karma. Understand? Therefore, this belongs to Jnanakandaha only. You should not have any doubt. Therefore, now you can remain quiet. Let me start writing my commentary on this Upanishad. Lord Shankara Bhagavatpada, when he declared, then he starts his commentary. This is only Avatarika Bhashyam contents. It is before entering into Purnamadaha. Imagine if we enter into from now, we only completed the month, the Upanishad. Now we have to go verse by verse, the commentary, isn't it? Anyway, it's very, lots of things. I want to do a small aarti there in Bhagavan. Just one minute, okay? And I'll give you aarti, because we'll complete, start the Upanishad, and then we are completing into Upanishad, so the aarti will finish it, okay? Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.